Hello, my name is Christus Vernihoff. I'm a Senior Public Health Officer at Barnsley Council, and I led the process of introducing and implementing a high-fat, salt or sugar advertising policy guidance note in Barnsley. There's a couple of reasons why I put these slides together and recorded a voiceover. I should say this needs to be done in one take. I'm using Canva, so apologies if I'm umming and ahhing or making the odd mistake here and there, or just not making sense at all. Or if you can hear my dogs barking in the background. But the first reason is that we've had quite a lot of interest from other areas, other local authorities, charities, universities, and so on about our approach in Barnsley. So this kind of provides that without me delivering very similar presentations over and over again. And the second reason is that by the time you're listening to this, I'm not going to be at Barnsley Council anymore. I'm going to be honing my skills for the next 5 years or so as a public health registrar. So because of that, my contact details will change quite frequently as I move around different placements. So I've added my personal email address to the end of these slides. And obviously my Twitter handle is on your screen now. So if you want to help me on my way to become internet famous, then please do give me a follow. But also if you just want to talk about HFSS stuff or anything public health generally, then that's fine too. So anyway, HFSS advertising, perfectly demonstrated by the image on the right here, which was taken in Barnsley, and it shows a telephone box advertising a burger with a bush shelter, literally 4 or 5 metres down the road, advertising a burger as well. And this is absolutely everywhere in Barnsley. It's absolutely everywhere in Yorkshire. It's everywhere in the country. So I'm very passionate about tackling this issue, as I really think there's scope to massively change things. And I hope in the future, you know, we do see that change and we can look back proudly at our contributions within our local areas. So these are the subheadings to the slides within this presentation. I hope it follows a logical and somewhat chronological order in relation to the process that we took in Barnsley. So beginning with an overview of the process, moving on to framing the problem, developing the policy guidance note, implementing it, and then kind of laying out what our ambition is and what our next steps are locally. I should say that a lot of this is based on my memory, so there will be things that happened and things that we did that I might miss, probably will miss, but I hope there's some value nonetheless within the slides. So for us in Barnsley, the policy guidance note took around 18 months to get across the line. Across the 15 local authorities within Yorkshire and Humber, we had the ADPH Commission support of Sustain, the food charity, to help us with developing policies in our local areas. And we had that support during COVID times, essentially. But obviously COVID really did disrupt things and it made it quite difficult to maintain momentum, and progress was, you know, because of that, quite fragmented throughout. However, knowing what I know now, I reckon it would probably take around 6 months, maybe less. And certainly I've noticed regionally, if not nationally, that this particular area of work is really gathering momentum. It's on the agenda, it's on the radar of many other areas. So with that considered, it could probably be achieved quite rapidly under favourable conditions. Which brings me on to the bottom half of this slide, which says, you know, the timescales depend on multiple factors. So is there an existing advertising and sponsorship policy in place? If so, excuse me, do you know who wrote it? Who is responsible for updating it? Is that person or is that team easily accessible? And are they receptive to your communications and your questions? Does your DPH strongly support? If you have a proactive and an enthusiastic director of public health that's got your back, that's willing to support you through any resistance, then, you know, you're well on your way. If you don't have that, then, you know, prioritize that and try and make sure that they are in your corner, that they do understand, that they do support what you're trying to get across the line. Is there a project lead with the capacity to maintain momentum? So it really does need somebody who is willing to keep this on the agenda, willing to keep knocking at the door, especially if that door is you know, firmly closed most of the time. If momentum slows down with this, it can easily fall to the bottom of the pile of leadership priorities. Which brings me on to political priorities. So elected members, are they on board? Do they recognise this as an important issue, or are they focused on something else like climate change, fuel poverty, cost of living crisis, and various other things, all of which are obviously very important. But you know, it's hard to have multiple priorities. If you can, again, get your cabinet spokesperson for public health briefed, get them in your corner. That really, really helps. Council advertising revenue, does your council rely quite significantly from advertising revenue, or does it not really generate that much cash from advertising? If it doesn't, then there'll probably be much less resistance, certainly from a financial perspective, as there is essentially less of a risk. I'll get onto it shortly, but it's definitely worth doing an audit of all the advertising and sponsorship contracts that the council holds. That will tell you how much money the council brings in from advertising revenue. It will tell you what advertising space the council owns and where. You know, are they equally distributed across the town, across the city? Are they quite spread out? Are they concentrated within the centre? And it will also tell you what businesses, what companies advertise on those spaces and so on. You know, if you've got, let's say, 500 fixed traditional advertising spaces across your borough or across your area, but none of them are food or drink companies, then you should have very little resistance to actually getting this across the line, because it wouldn't affect any businesses in the first instance. And then final thing on here is relationship with comms and marketing. There are others, but relationship with comms and marketing. In my opinion, you need this part of the council to work with you and support you. You know, they've got a very large role to play, certainly at the business end when it comes to launching and implementing the policy. But they can also be really helpful too in the development of the policy. And the chances are that they're the ones that wrote any existing or previous advertising or sponsorship policy and may well manage the advertising contract that the council currently holds. So, process. I think for me, there were three key stages to this. And those three key stages were framing the problem, developing the policy, and launching the policy, and then obviously moving forward, there's implementation, there's monitoring, there's evaluation, which we're on with now. I'll talk about each one of these stages in more detail over the next few slides, but I put this particular slide in just to give that overview of the process that I went through, or we went through. Framing the problem involved writing multiple different papers, presenting to all five directorate management teams, or DMTs, across the council. So in Barnsley, we have place, communities, public health, children's services, and core. And each DMT looked at this from a different perspective. They had different questions, they had different concerns, different queries, and that was very useful, challenging, but useful. I actually ended up going to public health DMT three or four times in the early stages, but it was only when I had a proposed policy guidance note at hand that I went to the other DMTs and said, look, this is the issue. But look, this is the proposed solution. Well, it's not a solution. You know, I'm well aware that, you know, a HFSS policy guidance note is not going to solve obesity. It may not even directly impact people's purchasing or eating behaviours, but it's a step in the right direction. I presented to Barnsley leadership team and eventually to the senior management team, which is made up of all the executive directors as well as the chief executive. And that was the level of governance that we needed in Barnsley to make that decision to approve and implement. In some councils, it may need to go to cabinet if it's deemed to be a political decision. If you're wondering what the difference between BLT, unfortunate acronym, and SMT is, then BLT for us includes executive and strategic directors. And it essentially just provides a much broader opportunity for consultation and discussion. So it's, you know, a half an hour chunk of time that I had to go there, get necessary feedback, get approval, get support, not approval, but get support for developing the policy guidance note. And I also briefed the cabinet spokesperson for public health. For developing the policy, as I mentioned a couple of minutes ago, completing an audit of advertising space and the contracts that we had in place, that was a key thing to do. We consulted other local authorities across the Yorkshire and Humber. So, you know, we had that commission support from Sustain, and that meant that we met monthly or bi-monthly, I can't remember anymore. But that was great because we could bounce ideas off other areas across the region, you know, identify common barriers and kind of compare progress and help each other as well. I spoke to Bristol City Council two or three times, asked about their approach, obviously used their policy very much as a template. That was published, I think, in 2020 now. Might be 2021, but I think it was 2020. Time flies. Sustain, as I said before, Fran Bernard from Sustain was very, very helpful, supported us in Barnsley even after the commissioned support had ended. She looked over various draft versions of our proposed policy. She answered questions and queries that I had, and she's been in touch since. And we wrote multiple drafts of this essentially until we were happy. And then launching the policy, at this stage, even more parts of the council became involved, mainly comms and marketing, the digital team as well, in terms of getting the website set up, getting it ready to be changed on June 6th, rather, when we launched. One thing we did make sure to do was to contact businesses prior to the public launch to explain the policy, explain how it impacts them moving forward, and offer them support or guidance should they need it. So, you know, for example, if we had a bakery advertising and they were advertising scones or scones, depending on how you pronounce it, or other high-fat baked goods, it would be a case of, you know, saying to them, look, we can help you identify products within your range that would be non-HFSS. Chances are bakery does bread as well, which would typically be non-HFSS, but yeah, you get the idea. Framing the problem. So there's quite a few slides on this, I think 4 or 5 slides. I think this was a big chunk of it. And this is all about getting the decision makers to understand the issue of HFSS product, but also HFSS advertising, as well as the rationale and the need for change, and that change beginning obviously with an HFSS advertising policy guidance note. So for me, when framing the problem, framing the issue, as we almost always do with public health, I just went to the data and used that as the backbone to my argument, I suppose. So focusing on excess weight among adults, but particularly among children as well. Childhood obesity tends to have particular clout, I should say, when forming an argument and influencing people. But I also used visual dental decay among 5-year-olds as an indicator. You know, I just went on POF, the Public Health Outcomes Framework fingertips tool, looked at all the relevant indicators that I could use to form an argument. Obviously, a lot of HFSS ads are for extremely high sugar products, particularly high sugar drinks, which we know are not great for oral health. I explained the research evidence in the influence between HFSS advertising, I still can't say that after all these months, and our purchasing and eating behaviour, and the particular susceptibility of children and young people when it comes to that type of advertising and marketing. I also used industry figures. There's a market research team called Kantar. They publish a lot if you just give them a Google. But yeah, used advertising and marketing figures. I think off the top of my head, I think it's about 2.5% of advertising, food and drink advertising rather, is on fruit and veg. The spend on confectionery is X times the amount of that spent on fruit and veg. I can't remember the exact figures, but they were kind of, I used them within the papers and some of the presentations that I delivered. And although there's now a delay on this, we call it a U-turn, but I think it's more of a delay. At the time, I also used the impending legislation to ban HFSS food and drink products online and on TV before 9 p.m. with a suggestion that the marketing budget allocation of these big HFSS companies and retailers and producers will move away from online and move away from TV because they simply won't be allowed to advertise there. But that does mean that all the money they allocate to advertising will be put on traditional marketing in less regulated spaces. And that less regulated space is basically high streets, town centres. So as for the rationale, it sort of creates itself by explaining the issue above. But I lent on what's been done elsewhere to good effect. So the Transport for London Network, the positive research findings that have come out of that via the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, talked about the Bristol City Council policy and what they've done, highlighted the flaws in, flaws and loopholes, I suppose, in our existing advertising and sponsorship policy. So I think the wording within our policy before was something like, you know, we won't advertise unhealthy products. We won't advertise junk food. But those two terms, unhealthy and junk food, are very much open to interpretation. And therefore, there's loopholes there. What one person deems healthy, another person deems unhealthy. So we needed to kind of cement that and use HFSS as an improvement, I suppose. And I link to wider strategies and priorities of the council, explaining how an HFSS advertising policy guidance note complements and aligns with the overarching policies or priorities rather of the council. And by doing so, it makes it harder for counter arguments to hold too much validity. And if the council said, you know, we want to improve the health of children, or you know, enable adults to live healthy lives and grow old healthily, etc., why wouldn't you want to you know, implement healthier advertising policy and so on? On that, if your area has signed and committed to a healthy weight declaration, Barnsley hasn't yet, but that is an ambition, then you can rely and lean on that and say, look, we've publicly committed to achieving action on reducing children's exposure to junk food advertising. That's one of the 16 commitments, I believe. So this literally does that. So yeah, if you've got a healthy weight declaration in your area, thread that into yeah, kind of your papers and your presentations. Sorry, just check. I've not just skipped a slide. Bear with me. No, I haven't. Okay, so quite early on, I found myself explaining what HFSS advertising is, and I soon established that the easiest way to do that was with a photograph or a series of photographs. A picture can paint 1,000 words, or so the saying goes. So I made a collage of lots of photographs taken in Barnsley. It was actually our COVID marshals at the time, so we were in lockdown when all this was happening, and I asked the COVID marshals to, basically, as they were roaming around the streets, around the town centre, if you see any HFSS ads, just take a photo and send them in. So I got quite a few back, which was really, really helpful. But this helped to visually demonstrate the local issue, as well as the scale and concentration of HFSS ads across our town. If you didn't have the capacity to go around taking photos, you could use Google Maps and just have a look around your streets, bus stops, telephone boxes, etc. You'll find loads of HFSS ads. And the influence of that advertising as well, that, you know, it may be having on our residents. So many times I'd finish a presentation and someone would say to me, oh, I feel hungry now, or, you know, I could just eat a plate of fries after seeing that, without realizing that they'd perfectly demonstrated the point of how influential advertising can be. Now, I wanted to do something a bit different, engage Barnsley leadership team. So instead of presenting using PowerPoint or Canva like I am today, I created a sort of journey, I suppose, using Mirror Board, which is a virtual whiteboard, essentially. So no slides, just one shared screen where I could navigate and take people through the journey from the what and the why through to the proposed policy, what's been done elsewhere, how it's been validated, what the next steps to take are. And one part of this, which, you know, I've blown up and pasted on the right hand side of the screen here, is a diagram that I use to explain how the proposed policy guidance, or how this issue is relevant to all parts of the council, and it not just being a public health issue. So I talked about how this impacts Barnsley through a tourism lens, making our towns and streets more visually appealing, reducing litter and HFSS packaging that overflows from bins and blows around the streets, and which in itself is advertising. From a financial perspective, so finance sits in the core services directorate at Barnsley, I suggested that actually this creates potential for increased advertising revenue. You know, it makes businesses aware that we have this advertising space, and it might make them come forward and advertise the healthy products that they sell. But even if it didn't, you know, the potential reduced economic impact of diet-related ill health, diet-related disease, you know, might reduce, which is great. You know, that's reason enough to take this step. You know, how many billions does obesity and diabetes and all the other comorbidities cost us every year? Billions. I was always realistic that this isn't going to solve obesity, and it might not even have a quantifiable effect at all. But it's a statement of intent. It's a step towards a greater ambition, and, you know, it's movement in the right direction for enabling people to make healthier choices. It just makes things that little bit easier for people, rather than being bombarded and influenced by, you know, unhealthy advertising. This slide and the next one, they're not necessarily part of this presentation. They're taken out of other presentations, and I've just included them to use as examples, essentially, when framing the problem to explain HFSS products and HFSS marketing. So I won't read through this. You can pause here if you wish to, if you do want to read through it. But there are, as I'm sure you'll know, a few more technicalities to the nutrient profiling model. For instance, if a product scores more than 11 A points, then you can't score it for protein unless it also scores 5 or more for fruit, veg, and nut content. So there is a bit more technicality to it, a bit more complex. It is a bit more complex, but generally the audience don't really want to know the nitty-gritty details of the nutrient profiling model, and you can always just add the link if they do. This one here, for presentations where I've had a bit more time, I've used this activity just to get the audience involved, as well as to demonstrate the power and influences of industry advertising and marketing. And I would probably do this activity with you now, but because I'm literally talking to myself and there's no one around me, I can't. But essentially, we go through these left to right, top from bottom, and name the brands. They're very, very easy to begin with. You know, McDonald's, KFC, Kellogg's, Domino's, Coca-Cola, Burger King, Nestle, etc., etc. Then we get to Chiquita, Arla, and Dole. And for these, I actually ask the audience, you know, I said, look, the brand names are in plain sight apart from Arla. Most people get Arla. But for Chiquita and Dole, the brand names are in plain sight. Do you know what these companies actually produce? Surprisingly, a lot of people do. You know, Chiquita, world's biggest banana company. Dole, biggest producer of fresh fruit and veg in the world. So usually they see Dole and say fruit. And yeah, brilliant. I'll get onto it in a second, why I include these. Quaker, right at the end, I say that actually there's a little bit of a curveball because Quaker is actually owned by PepsiCo, and PepsiCo own brands like Walker's Crisps, Coca-Cola own Costa Coffee, loads of different companies as well. Nestle own over 2,000 different brands. And the slide is there to demonstrate the impact of advertising and our association between images and colours and shapes and brands and the products that we then link to them. So, you know, just this particular shade of purple makes us think of chocolate, particularly a certain brand of chocolate. The kernel, we think of fried chicken. And it's not because we're ever taught this. It's because we're exposed to this every day of our lives, online, on social media. You know, you flick through your phone, every other advert is junk food. On TV, on billboards, telephone boxes, and so on. It's literally everywhere, isn't it? And advertising works extremely well. We know it does. That's why so much money is invested into advertising. And these big players here, as well as a few others, have that advertising space completely monopolized, which may explain why we're less familiar with Dole and Arla and Chiquita, despite them actually being much bigger companies than a lot of the others. You know, I think all three of them are bigger than Domino's and Burger King in terms of annual turnover and revenue. So moving on to developing the policy. This happened after I'd been to Public Health DMT and BLT. So the proposed policy was then taken to all DMTs and SMT for approval and sign-off. But the development process for us was relatively straightforward. Knowing that I had the backing of most senior managers in the council, I approached our comms and marketing team. I asked them for support with the policy development, and I had an allocated or designated comms and marketing manager who was incredibly helpful, really engaged with the work, really proactive. And I think that's a real bonus. If you can find colleagues who can get things done and share your enthusiasm that are in different parts of the council that have strengths that you don't, then it really, really does help. So if you think of your comms and marketing team, if you've got a particular contact in there, you know, approach them and see if they'll help get them on board. I also had the support from a couple of colleagues in public health who looked at the Bristol policy and produced a first draft policy for Barnsley, very much based on that. We also used the Taken Down Junk Food Ads Toolkit that Sustain published, I'm going to say last year. If you Google those words, Taken Down Junk Food Ads, you'll be able to find that very easily. I'm sure most people listening to this will probably have already had sight of that. But you can download it as PDF. I'd recommend doing that if you haven't already. With our first draft policy, we sat down, we went through it line by line. It took ages. went through it line by line, made sure it made sense to us, because if it didn't make sense or complete sense to us, we knew it wouldn't make any sense to businesses and prospective advertising clients in the future. So we made, you know, multiple tweaks, multiple amendments, and then we sent it to Fran at Sustain for her comments and feedback as well. And we combined that feedback with the comments that we got from DMTs, which ultimately made it clearer and meant that we, you know, added a decision table at the back, which is what you can see on the screen here. You probably can't read it, it'll be too small. But that essentially was a quick fire way for businesses to determine what would be accepted and what would be rejected. You'll notice there's quite a few ambers on this first column here, second column rather, and that's because it's a yes, but, or yes, if these certain criteria are met. We then jazzed it up a bit. We added our corporate branding, took it to SMT for final sign-off, which thankfully we got, and moved on to launch. So once the policy was approved, we scheduled a launch date, and that meant liaising with our digital team or IT team to make sure that the website was, you know, we kind of said what changes needed to take place and what date that needed to go live, which for us was the 6th of June, 2022. It meant comms and marketing preparing the internal comms messages, preparing a series of social media posts, preparing a quoted press release. And I think I mentioned it before we launched on the 6th of June, we made sure to contact all the food and drink businesses that currently advertise with the council to basically give them a heads up and offer and support and give them any guidance should they want it or should they need it. The last thing we wanted to do was to burn bridges or surprise any small businesses in particular. As you know, as a council, we obviously want small businesses to thrive and do well, and we want to support them however we can, as you know, they're a big part of our local economy. The launch itself went very well. I did a radio interview with BBC Sheffield. We had articles written by BBC News, the Daily Mail, loads of third sector food and obesity organisations, lots of tweets, lots of inquiries. I think we had like a Danish TV company wanting to come and do some sort of documentary. We declined that one though. there wasn't really any criticism. It wasn't negatively received in any way, which was really, really good to see, but not entirely unexpected. So I previously contacted Bristol City Council comms team and just asked about the public and media's response when they announced their policy and then when they launched their policy. And they said that theirs was very positively received. You know, they had the odd negative Facebook comment, but, you know, 99% positive, which is great, really encouraging. One thing we didn't do, which I think would have been good to do in hindsight, and if I did this again, I probably would do this, is some sort of public consultation, get the perceptions, get the thoughts and opinions of the public that this is essentially serving. I think, in all honesty, if we went into the town centre and did some sort of public consultation now on this, I would hazard a guess that most people would say, I don't know what you're talking about. I didn't know there was a policy implemented, you know, and that's fine, because this is all about that kind of subconscious nudge. It's not about telling people to not buy this or not drink this, not eat this. It's about subconsciously changing the external environment without really people realizing it too much or getting upset about it. I would do some form of public consultation if I was to do this again. Definitely before, definitely after, or perhaps some sort of focus group to get people's opinions. And I think getting people's getting young people's opinions and children's opinions would be quite interesting as well. Initial challenges. In fact, I think I might have just missed something on here. Let me just check. I did contact, so I mentioned Bristol Councils. Last thing on there was the comms and marketing manager that I worked closely with. They tracked all the response that we had, all the engagement that we had. I think they used something, I think it was called Coverage Book, and I might be wrong with that, but your comms and marketing team will probably have something similar. But essentially, it tracks all the engagements, all the estimated views, all the projected audiences, all the comments, etc., And essentially that gives you some form of evaluation in terms of engagement. Okay, we can move on now. See, that would be something I would edit out, but yeah, can't do that for some reason on Canva. Initial challenges. So the teething problems, I suppose, which so far have been entirely internal. So the first one, I soon realized that the news of this was a surprise to some parts of the council. And in hindsight, that's completely understandable. One of the reasons for presenting and briefing all five directorate management teams of the council was that service managers within those meetings could feed back to their teams within the directorate so that it kind of filtered down to the relevant officers on the ground, so to speak. That obviously didn't quite happen, which again is fine and understandable. There's about 3,000 employees within Barnsley Council. Not all of them are going to know, and that's okay. But as you can see from, you know, a couple of these redacted emails that I was CC'd into, there were a few ruffled feathers and a couple of snidey remarks and sarcastic comments. Some people don't like change. Some people are reluctant to think outside the box. For instance, this first one on the left, we can easily advertise afternoon teas in a museum. We can use images of tea, coffee, healthy sandwiches, strawberries, other fruits, whatever else. You know, it doesn't just have to be cream and cakes that you put on that advert. It just you just need a bit of imagination, and there are usually ways around things. I must say this was very isolated, not a reflection of 99.9% of the council. Did make me laugh, to be honest. The other challenge has been in relation to our organic posts. So advertising that is unpaid, essentially. So for instance, in Barnsley, we have Market Kitchen within Glassworks. I'm not sure if anyone listened to this has been to Barnsley, but I highly recommend it. It's made up of loads of different units that are leased out by loads of different food and drink vendors, a huge variety of different foods. And I think, and don't quote me on this, as part of their lease agreement with us, the council, we give them X amount of mentions on our Instagram page per month, on our Glassworks Instagram page per month. So we essentially include a bit of promotion for them. Now, although the policy does not technically apply to unpaid advertising, we certainly don't want to undermine the policy in any way by, you know, posting images of HFSS products. So it's very important that we adhere to the policy within our own communications. And this was actually really easily resolved. You know, I met a couple of times with the designated comms team that control the Glassworks Instagram page and Facebook page, explained how the policy applied, how things would need to change slightly, showed and explained examples of what is not appropriate and then examples of what would be. So the example on the left here is from before with a burger. I think the other two images are probably fine. And then on the right, the image with, you know, I think it's poached eggs and avocado on probably sourdough, and then some sort of fruit smoothie bowl or something. Easy change. Oh, and then top right, I mean, it looks like an espresso martini, if I'm honest, but I'm going to say it's a coffee. And actually, the policy doesn't apply to alcohol. That's within the overarching advertising and sponsorship policy. But I think this could have been prevented if we'd have launched internal comms before the public announcement, just to give us that little bit of extra time to iron out any issues internally, respond to any concerns within, you know, certain teams of the council before we kind of shouted about it all publicly. But quite minor challenges on the whole. So ambition and next steps. I mean, our ambition is ultimately to protect children and adults through all but eliminating exposure to HFSS advertising. But to do that, we need more than just the council to restrict HFSS advertising. We need other organisations, anchor institutions to do the same. And ultimately, we need owners of private advertising space to get on board. And we need other areas to do the same. You know, if we have combined authorities or entire counties aligned with this, then we have a much better chance of influencing more broadly. So the next steps for Barnsley are essentially to do just that. Work with others to do the same. The transport network, the hospital, the college, South Yorkshire Combined Authorities. We can also try to influence industry. You know, if we look further upstream and try to address the people and the companies and businesses that are creating the products or choosing which products to advertise, then we wouldn't actually need to implement policies to restrict HFSS products. You know, if big fast food chains, for instance, made the decision that 90% or 100% or 80%, whatever, a high percentage of their product advertising would be for non-HFSS products, then we'd be quite happy, wouldn't we? So yeah, I think that's it. Get in touch. Feel free to get in touch. I've added the comms and marketing email address for Barnsley, as well as the generic public health email address. So if you email publichealth@barnsley.gov.uk, that inbox is monitored Monday to Friday, 9 to 5, and emails are kind of delegated to the appropriate colleague in public health, whatever it's about. As I said at the start, if you're listening to this, I'm no longer at Barnsley Council, and I'll be moving around various places. So if you want to get in touch with me personally, then I put my email address here for you, christus_fernihoff@hotmail.com. And like I said, you can also follow me on Twitter. But thank you for listening to this. The time says 35 minutes and 55 seconds. So I'm going to take it to 36 and call it a day. So again, thanks for listening.